Ladies and gentlemen, he is home. Zay is in the building.
That he is.
Welcome home, man. What's been happening?
I'm glad to be here. Man, nothing much. You know, making an album, having babies.
He said having babies.
Stuff like that. Before we go any deeper, though, because I'm just on the radio right now, for anybody I did not tell I was in town, please don't get at me, because this is last minute for myself also.
Most definitely. Ladies and gentlemen, Zay is home. More music is on the way. Stay with us, Power 94.
Yeah, yeah, white train break my heart, white train help change my mind. Yeah, lights on in the crib, lights on on my bitch. Yeah, nicer than I feel, darker than I feel. Yeah, lights on my kids, lights out in the crib.
What parts do you feel like you inherited from your mom?
All of it.
Damn, all of it?
That's so deep.
Mm-hmm. Like what, or what, let's say maybe like your most prominent characteristics you think you've inherited
my
from your
face.
Mom. Okay.
My face, bro.
Let me see.
You got a cute
my face. Yeah, probably
my face,
yeah.
Y'all
glasses.
Think y'all look alike?
No, mom look a lot alike.
Take your glasses off. Let's see.
Let's see.
We're the same person.
I guess I kind of see it now.
You kind of see it.
Yeah, kind of.
I think I made them weird. I'm just now kind of realizing that. I'm just now kind of realizing I fucked them up a little bit.
Say more about that.
Like, say more. Not about letting that. Them go to daycare. Not letting them pretend. You know, taking stuff away, like not letting them have a pretend Christmas thing, like Santa Claus coming down or the Easter Bunny thing. I don't know. I just keep, sometimes I go back and forth with myself and say, and then I get back at myself and say, girl, no, did good, girl. No.
I don't know what to call it. What's it called? We don't have a whole bunch of, we didn't grow up with a whole bunch of false expectations.
Because you can't, you don't have to fake it. Nothing is fake. Anything in this world you can have. You can have it. Everything is possible if you want to move with it. Now, if you got, but you got to put in the work, I think.
Mm-hmm.
You got to put in the work.
So when Zay started to pursue music, what was your reaction? Like in a serious way, what was your feelings and reaction about it?
Why you outside for? What you doing in the middle of the night for?
But I always
thought I was running drugs.
But you was in the studio?
He was, and I was so glad, and I thank God that he wasn't, because he could have been doing a million other things. Because when they started selling drugs, next door, I was like, oh my God, we gotta move.
How old was they when this was happening?
Probably 11.
11.
So you were cognizant of this happening?
I knew what was going on around us.
Uh-huh. In the trajectory of these places that you lived, at what point did you start working on music?
I've been writing music since I was like 8, 9. I used to just write fan fiction and poetry on the computers.
Mm-hmm.
And then that was it. I'd spent most of my time at school writing raps.
Mm-hmm.
Especially like, cause I hated being there.
You had beats and you were just
writing
too?
I didn't have beats. I just had songs and I just write, period.
I
ain't start writing on beats till I was like 16.
Okay, how did that start?
I decided I was actually gonna rap. It was like, it went from a hobby to like, maybe I could actually do this.
What flipped that switch?
I heard my voice on a record.
Mm-hmm.
Where'd you do that?
We was recording on a MacBook at school.
Mm-hmm.
It was like one of those big ass ones, like GarageBand, but we didn't have a mic. The mic was in the screen of the computer.
Mm-hmm.
So we would stand at the edge of it and record the verse. We made a whole mixtape and shit.
Mm-hmm.
After I heard myself on there, I was like, well, yeah, I can't do nothing else.
This is just a cool moment, man. Just going back in time, watching when you first got signed to now. I've just been a fan, you know, the whole time. You know what I mean? And at the time, a lot of people were bringing music, and I was listening to it. And then Tracy was like, "Zay doing some music," and I listened to it, and it blew my brain. But I didn't want to be like, "This dude's so dope."
There a moment when Zay was really taking off in the beginning that you were like, "Okay, I don't have to worry as much anymore now"?
Because
never.
Mm-mm. Just think, 21. He left. He went to MTSU a few years.
Mm-hmm.
But he was still back and forth home. Now he's 21, 22. He finna leave.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my God. My baby. He's just a baby. And he would always say, "Mommy, you taught me right. You and Pop, you taught me right." And he have. And he done did good. Even though he been stupid and did stupid shit, he did good.
Is that how you think about some of the challenges that Isaiah's had over the years, the stupid shit.
Isaiah, a conqueror, though. Mm-hmm. That's the thing. Everything he do, even when he fuck up, it's so casual.
Do you feel like your mom is saying that you take things casually?
My feelings have been hurt about a lot of stuff over, like, time. And so I guess the way I cope with it is not taking too much anything seriously no more. Like, I've had three fathers in my life, mm-hmm. all right? And so going from my dad, George, and that's where all my expectations kind of just went away. Mm-hmm. It kind of just went away because, you know what I'm saying, you wait on the porch for a nigga for 6 hours.
Mm-hmm. You waiting on the porch with your papa. Papa standing there ain't saying that. Papa standing there like this.
You want to take your book bag in? You want to take your book bag in? You ain't got to have it on while you're waiting for it.
So
that type of shit. Yeah. That type of shit. It's like whatever.
So, Miss Tracy, mm-hmm. when Zay's perspective on his father in his life shows up in his music, like mm-hmm. on Sylvia Demo yeah. or on Son's Tirade, how yeah. do you feel when you listen to it?
I didn't know. Because Pop was always here. And between 3 and 4, he had his biological. So I thought Pop was making up for bullshit. Mm-hmm. But me not having a dad raised mm-hmm. by a single parent, mm-hmm. I didn't know that. Mm-hmm. I didn't know that.
You can't replace a nigga.
Yeah, you can't. I didn't know. You can't replace a nigga. I didn't know that. But I thought you could.
Right now, from where you are, in your art, in your life, do you feel like that hurt from your father sort of stepping out? Do you feel like that's resolved?
It probably is emotionally damaging me. Mm-hmm. And like, I'm probably not handling it the right way. But, mm-hmm.
Have you heard the new album?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he sent me the album before anybody. I'll text him and say, what you doing in your studio? He'll send me a song. And it really make my day.
With the house is burning specifically, how are you both feeling about it as a unit?
I'm scared. Things have changed so much with just a little bit. Mm-hmm. And I'm just scared of not having the same connection with my family.
Like, if it's very successful, you feel like you'll become disconnected?
I'm just people thinking of me outside of the way that I think of myself. Mm-hmm. I'm like, I'm just me. I would hate for like my cousin to be like, to cover me. Or idolize me in any type of way. Mm-hmm. When my main thing is, if you like yourself as much as I like myself, mm-hmm. you'll be able to do it. I really would still be writing raps if I didn't mm-hmm. do this type of shit. Yeah. So that's I'm most scared about like just being too busy to like talk to people or having too much noise around me where they can formulate their own idea mm-hmm. of me mm-hmm. and then not put the same type of respect into themselves. Like, I believe it. I believe everybody I know, if they really wanted to like put their mind to it, I'm from Chat. Like, if you could do it.
Yeah.
So we're here at your elementary
Calvin school. Donaldson. Uh-huh. Calvin Donaldson Elementary, yeah.
And so what was your experience like here?
It was cool. I was pretty to myself kid. Like, I had older cousins, but they were way older than me. Mm-hmm. I was the only child till I was like 7. So, like, this was like the first time I had like real interaction.
What does it feel like to be back?
I mean, it feels refreshing to be here. I was nervous at first because I hadn't been here. And especially doing something like, kind of like this as cool as this. Mm-hmm. I wasn't sure if all my family was gonna be able to like pull up and everything, so. But it's been fun.
I'm really interested in knowing what it was like just coming up as an artist in this place. Mm-hmm. You know, because I think when people think about Tennessee music cities, they think, especially in hip hop, you think about like Memphis, right?
Usher's from here.
You, Usher.
Usher's
okay.
from here.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that was the whole, and Samuel Jackson's from here.
Okay.
So that was the whole like inspiration to me.
Okay.
And I ain't know nobody who knew them. Mm-hmm. So I ain't never thought I had to know anybody. Mm-hmm. I feel like I had like that, it was like some blind shit at first. It was like, you work hard, the universe will lead you to wherever you want to go. Mm-hmm. And I kind of leaned on that for a long time.
Can you compare the experience of making music in LA to making music here as a younger person?
I can't make music at home. Like at home?
Like at home, like your mom's house or in chat?
And here now, because when I come here, I just want to kick it.
Okay.
So I can't make music where I want to kick it at. Uh-huh. Music is like a be in the zone.
type of thing.
Does LA feel like your workplace or your home?
Workplace. Mm-hmm. Definitely my workplace. It's not too much for me to do except either get in trouble or go to work. Mm-hmm. So.
By get in trouble.
You know, I've talked about how I can get in trouble. Mm-hmm. Get in trouble, you do dumb things. You know, it's a lot of things to get into in LA.
Yeah. You know, it's public that you came home in the 5 years that in between now and the Sun's tirade.
Yeah.
And so can you just tell me a little bit about that experience when you came home?
I was putting on a project in the middle of me kind of like being in the midst of a crisis. Mm-hmm. And so I came here in the long end of the crisis. And it kind of sucked. The only difference between now or anything else and then was like a self-starting and motivation and giving myself a reason to do anything, to get up in the morning. It's deeper than rap. Like get up in the morning and make sure like I organize my crib and make sure I'm talking to my family and mm-hmm. keeping myself together type of shit. It was way deeper than rap and I wasn't like doing that shit.
Mm-hmm. And so when you came home.
I kind of gave up on myself.
And yeah. I feel like, you know, things that you've talked about, depression.
I just kind of stress. I kind of overstress myself sometimes.
And you think that leads to indulging in the vices?
No, it just give me excuses to do shit that I probably wouldn't do unless I felt like I gave myself a reason like the world was doing something to me or somebody was doing something to me. I understand like alcoholism and like drug addiction is like in my genes. So I want to do it anyway, probably. As soon as you get introduced to it, you want to do it. That's never gonna go away. And I think part of the responsibility is me understanding that and knowing that.
What was different for you in making this album compared to your past two projects?
Probably the amount of control that I've like, I'm not being a control freak. Mm-hmm. I'm like only really dealing with the music and I'm trusting people to do other shit.
And you were sober making most of this album? Uh-huh. All of it or most of it?
Most of it.
Most of it, what was that experience like?
It was weird at first, because mm-hmm. I didn't realize I hadn't been sober making any music.
And so it was new, but did you enjoy it? Did you enjoy making music this way?
It was a confidence builder. This was crazy. Not being faded was the confidence challenge I need to believe in myself.
Mm-hmm. To know that it's not like the drugs.
You can do anything faded. Mm-hmm. You can make a 5-verse drunk. Mm-hmm. Sober, talk about your experience, and like enjoy it and really believe in yourself without embellishing, it's a challenge.
So ultimately, what does The House is Burning mean to you?
It's like a scenario that like you either can like lay down with the flames or die from trying to hold on to material things and shit like that, or you can get out in a timely manner. And if it all burns down, like, are you still going, you're still going to try to figure it out, right? Because if not, you might as well just lay in that motherfucker. Mm-hmm. You got to start over. And shit, sometimes you got to start over 2, 3, 4 times, man. 5 times, 6 times.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? However many times it takes for you to get the message to yourself. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? This is just that type of shit. That's all it means. Sometimes you got to start over. You got to have the courage, though.
I'm Isaiah Rashad's pop. I raised him since he was 3. He would say, he would tell you, I'm the reason. I've loved music before it even loved me. And I hope that music influences everyone's life the way that it has mine, because this is my contribution back to the world. And for something that I've loved for so long, I just try to make sure that y'all love him the same, you know. Because sharing it with the world has been the hardest part for me. I just need the world to interpret his mindset and his words and try to understand where he's going and where he's coming from, because it's complex. You know what I'm saying? He got a way of drawing you in. It's love.